Welcome to our lecture series, the series of the Harvard Ukrainian Research Institute. For those of you who don't know me, I'm Sergei Plotky, the director of the institute and professor of Ukrainian history here at Harvard. This is our second event in our series on Ukrainian Revolution, Ukraine in Flames. And we are really very pleased and honored to welcome here at Harvard our today's speaker, Anne Applebaum, who is a Pulitzer Prize winning author of Gulag, and just recently, in the last few weeks, her book, which is called Red Famine, Stalin's War on Ukraine, was released in the United Kingdom and here in the United States. I generally advise my students not to use Wikipedia, but I use it from time to time. And one thing that you find about Anne Applebaum on Wikipedia is that she is an American journalist. And this is certainly is true, but then you go and look at the places where she worked, where she lived. Today she's a visiting professor of practice at the London School of Economics. She worked for The Economist, Spectator, was a member of the editorial board of Washington Post, and you understand and realize that categories that we use to put ourselves in the box of countries and nationalities don't work anymore. So this is, I guess, the example of globalization at its best. And again, judging by the same Wikipedia article, it looks like that Anne Applebaum first went global really in the late 1980s, covering the fall of Berlin Wall and these revolutionary changes in Eastern Europe. The book that she published partially as the result of those experiences between East and West across the borderlands of Europe was published for the first time in 1994, republished in 1995, and which is really very amazing for journalistic accounts, then saw another edition in 2015. As I already mentioned, Anne is a Pulitzer Prize winner. The book that brought that award and that recognition was Gulag, a History, that really either opened to the readers in the West, in particular in the United States and UK, the phenomenon of Gulag, the horror associated with that, or help many people in those countries to change their mind about Stalinism, about revolution, and went on then to publish a book on Eastern Europe, post-World War II Eastern Europe, titled Iron Curtain, The Crushing of Eastern Europe, 1944-1956, the book that I use in my classes here at Harvard. That Famine is the most recent addition to her wonderful books on the history of that part of the world. The Ukrainian Research Institute and I personally felt really very privileged to work with Anne on that book and encourage her any way we could do that. We were certainly very happy to share with you the results of our work in MAPA, Digital Atlas of Ukraine, the module on Holodomor. One thing that we didn't do, we didn't try to influence the interpretation of the events. And in that sense, the book for us has been as much a new thing and as much a revelation as to any other reader. One of unique things about this book is, compared to any other book dealing with the Great Ukrainian Famine or Holodomor, or famine in the Soviet Union in general around that time, it has a very different time frame. It starts relatively early, but in earnest it starts with the revolution of 1917, which certainly changes the perception, changes interpretation, changes understanding of those events. And also allowed us to put this talk based on the book in the series on the Ukrainian Revolution. So I suspect that you came here to hear Anne and not me. So I think this is a good point for me to pass the mic to Anne Applebaum. But before I do that, let's welcome her here.
Thank you. First of all, Serhii started by thanking me, but I'd like to start by thanking him, and he is too modest to say this, but the idea that I should tackle this subject or start thinking about Ukraine was his. It goes back several years. I noted in the introduction well before 2014, so well before Ukraine was an important news story, and we started talking about this subject and thinking about how it could be done in an era when we have so many archives. We spoke about it, and he essentially talked me into it, which I'm very grateful to. So I'm grateful for him, and I'm very grateful to the Harvard Ukrainian Institute, which supported the book in all kinds of ways, helping me find people to help with research, with advice, with maps, with all kinds of other things. So I'm really grateful to him and to Harvard, and so thank you. Thanks very much. I'm going to begin speaking by beginning with the spring of 1932. In the spring of 1932, the peasants of Ukraine and indeed all over the Soviet Union were beginning to starve. Secret police reports and letters were coming from all over the USSR, flooding into Moscow from Ukraine, as well as the North Caucasus and Volga region, speaking of children swollen with hunger, of families eating grass and acorns. In March, a medical commission found corpses lying on the street in a village near Odessa. In another village, local authorities were trying to conceal starvation. And there were even peasants writing directly to the Kremlin asking for an explanation and refusing to believe even then that the Soviet state was responsible. This is a quote from one of those letters. Every day, 10 to 20 families die from famine in the villages. Children run off and railway stations are overflowing. The bourgeoisie has created a genuine famine here, part of the capitalist plan to set the entire peasant class against the Soviet government. But the bourgeoisie had not created the famine. The Soviet Union's disastrous decision to force Soviet peasants off their land and to join collective farms, the deportation of kulaks, supposedly wealthier peasants, the chaos that followed all of these policies, which were ultimately linked to Stalin himself, this was his great revolutionary idea, these had led the countryside to the brink of starvation. And throughout the spring and summer of 1932, many of Stalin's colleagues were sending him, as I said, urgent messages from all over the USSR. And communist leaders in Ukraine particularly were especially desperate, and several wrote him long letters begging for help. Many of them believed in the summer of 1932 that a greater tragedy could still be avoided. The regime could ask for international assistance, as it had during a previous famine in 1921. It could halt grain exports. Soviet Union was then exporting grain to the West, or it could stop demanding grain from the peasants altogether. Instead, in the autumn of 1932, the Soviet Politburo, the elite leadership of the USSR, took a series of decisions that widened and deepened the famine, specifically in the Ukrainian countryside. They increased the state's demand for food in Ukraine, requiring blacklisted Ukrainian farms and villages and towns to contribute meat and vegetables as well as more grain to the state. They refused to halt the export of grain, which continued all through that year. Stalin considered hard currency critical to his program of industrialization. They prohibited Ukrainian peasants from traveling to Russia in search of food. In effect, they put a cordon around Ukraine. They blocked the roads between the Ukrainian villages and the cities. And at the height of the crisis, organized teams of policemen and party activists, motivated by hunger and fear and a decade of conspiratorial rhetoric, entered Ukrainian peasant households, and they took not just grain, as they did elsewhere, but everything. Potatoes, beets, squash, peas, anything in the oven, anything in the cupboard. They took farm animals, Sometimes they took pets, and sometimes they even took money and clothes. And the result, within a few weeks, and peaking in the spring of 1933, was a full-scale catastrophe. Ukrainian peasants, as I describe in the book, began doing almost anything to survive. They ate horses, dogs, cats. They cooked hedgehogs. They fried birds' eggs. They ate the bark of oak trees. One survivor, Nadia Lutishin, remembered, and I quote again here, "Frogs didn't last long. People caught them all. All the cats were eaten, the pigeons. People ate everything. I imagined the scent of delicious food as we ate weeds and roots." Some people survived because they had managed to hold on to a cow or because they had a cousin or a friend in the bureaucracy. Lots of people did slip around the roadblocks and escaped. This is a moment when many peasants sought to go to the big cities to melt into the proletariat so people wouldn't know where they came from. Some survived because the Soviet state, spotting another opportunity to exploit the famine, suddenly expanded its network of hard currency shops throughout Ukraine. These are places where peasants could trade gold and silver for food. People brought their wedding rings, heirloom jewelry, watches, Tsarist era coins and medals. Some people actually dug up graves to find more. At their peak in 1933, there were 1,500 of these Torxen shops in Ukraine, and they briefly became a crucial factor in Soviet international trade. Another quote, "For silver and gold, my mother received porridge, potatoes, or flour," one woman remembered. "All those products she mixed with different grasses and she gave us to eat once a day, and in that way we survived." Famously, some of you will know these stories, as people went hungry, they went mad. Law-abiding people began stealing food. Previously peaceful neighbors turned on their thieves, their neighbors, and lynched them. Famously, there were instances of cannibalism. Many of these things we know about now because they were reported by the police, they were recorded. They were sent back to Moscow, but there was no immediate reaction. As the situation became acute in the spring of 1933, Ukrainian peasants began to die in unusually large numbers. As I said, there was a broader Soviet famine, but in Ukraine the situation was special. Ukrainians traveled to the railways trying to get out. Many died in the stations. They died on the side of the road. The very few photographs that we have from this moment, actually the only ones we have that are believed to be authentic, taken by an Austrian engineer who happened to be in Kharkiv, shows people literally along the side of the road dying. And they died in such large numbers that there was often nobody to bury them. But the famine at this point was only half the story, because while the peasants were dying in the countryside, the Soviet secret police, the same people who were organizing the famine, simultaneously launched an attack on the Ukrainian intellectual and political elite. As it spread, a campaign of slander and oppression was launched against Ukrainian intellectuals, professors, museum curators, writers, artists, priests, theologians, public officials, and even Communist Party members. And that meant that anybody who was connected to the what had been the short-lived Ukrainian People's Republic, which existed for a few months in 1917, anybody who had promoted Ukrainian language or history, anybody with an independent literary or artistic career was liable to be vilified, jailed, sent to a labor camp, or executed. Unable to watch what was happening, Mykola Skripnik, one of the best-known leaders of the Ukrainian Communist Party, committed suicide. And one of Ukraine's best-known writers at that time, Mykola Filovy, also killed himself. In his suicide note, he spoke of the murder of a generation. In the aftermath of that, thousands of Ukrainian churches were physically destroyed, along with historical buildings and monuments in Kiev. Books were banned and art was confiscated. Even Ukrainian dictionaries were altered. A letter was dropped from the alphabet in order to make the language seem closer to Russian. Taken together, these two policies, the Holodomor in the winter and spring of 1933, and the repression of the Ukrainian intellectual and political class in the subsequent months and the subsequent year, brought about the Sovietization of Ukraine, the destruction of the Ukrainian national idea, and the neutering of any Ukrainian challenge to Soviet unity. Raphael Lemkin, the Polish Jewish lawyer who invented the word genocide, spoke of Stalin's assault on Ukraine as the, quote, classic example of his concept, his quote. It is a case of genocide, of destruction, not of individuals only, but of a culture and of a nation. But why? Why did Stalin do it? And why did so many people go along with his decision? To understand the origins of the Bolshevik and Stalin's particular animus against Ukraine, it's very important to go back in time. One of the things I found when I was working on this book was that the idea that you could write about the Ukrainian famine and focus only on 1932, 1933 was wrong, and that much of what Stalin is referring to and thinking about at the time really goes back a decade earlier. And when Stalin was dealing with Ukraine in the 1930s, he was not dealing with a new problem. And in this story, as in so many others, the event makes no sense unless you understand the prehistory. So for the Bolsheviks, the problem of Ukraine had a very precise starting point, and that is 1917. And that was a year not just of one revolution, but of several, as is often forgotten. In Moscow, of course, there were two. There's the February Revolution, which overthrew the Tsar, and then there's the Bolshevik coup d'etat in October. But in Kiev, there was a third revolution. It was spearheaded by a group of intellectuals, led, I'm glad to say, by a historian, Mikhailo Hrushevsky, and Sergei is the Mikhailo Hrushevsky professor here at Harvard. But from the first moment that they appeared, the Bolsheviks sought to undermine them. Why? Because the Ukrainian national leadership was revolutionary, but not Bolshevik. And their economics were actually very radical and included the demand for compulsory redistribution of land, something that made sense to Ukrainians. Ukrainians were peasants, still largely a peasant nation then. And the Ukrainian revolution was carried out with them in mind. But they also had very radical politics. And as Imperial Russia collapsed, Ukraine's leaders wanted to be part of the Spring of Nations that was then blossoming around the region. This is an era, of course, when Poland was recreated, having been divided 100 years earlier. Czechoslovakia, the Baltic states, became independent. All these states in the region had gained statehood and international recognition, and the Ukrainians wanted to join them. This desire ran immediately counter to the Bolsheviks' priorities, and even counter to their understanding of the world. As men educated in the Russian Empire, they had difficulty imagining a sovereign Ukraine or understanding that it could be possible. And for them, the territory of Ukraine, which was long seen by Russia as a kind of imperial colony, they actually knew, and many used the expression, that it was South Russia. As Marxists, they had very mixed feelings about peasants, whose revolutionary credentials they doubted. And as revolutionaries, they had no mixed feelings at all about the loss of access to Ukrainian grain. For God's sake, Lenin wrote to his comrades fighting in Ukraine in January 1918, use all energy and all revolutionary measures to send grain, grain, and more grain. Otherwise, Petrograd may starve to death. Use special trains and special detachments. Collect and store, escort the trains, inform us every day, for God's sake. Nobody was more sensitive to this call than Stalin, who was at this time directly responsible for Bolshevik policy in Ukraine. And as the People's Commissar for Nationalities in the first Bolshevik government, he not only denounced the Ukrainian Declaration of Sovereignty in 1917, he followed up with what we would now call active measures, the psychological games designed to destabilize the Ukrainian government. In a number of cities, and this may sound familiar to some of you, local Bolsheviks tried to establish so-called independent Soviet republics, so tiny Moscow-backed mini-states, which were, of course, not independent at all. And yes, it's familiar. In Kiev, they tried to carry out a coup d'etat. In Kharkiv, they sought to create a rival Ukrainian government. Eventually, they did conquer Kiev in February 1918, though they were expelled again a month later. They came back in February 1919, and this time they stayed in power for 7 months. They established a secret police force, they carried out mass arrests, they sent armed soldiers into the villages to requisition food, all policies that angered people who were already by 1919 exhausted by several years of war. And what was the result? It was a massive, violent peasant rebellion, probably the largest ever to take place in Europe. Leaders of Ukraine at this time were various, and they ranged from the populist Ataman Grigoriev to the anarchist Makhno, but they were united in their overwhelming hostility to the Bolsheviks, and their hostility to the grain requisitions, and hostility to the Cheka and the Soviet police state. Many believed in the ideals of the far left, you know, bread, peace, and land, and so on, but they hated the Soviet Communist Party, which they perceived as a foreign body in Ukraine. An observer who visited Ukraine on a Red Cross mission at that time paraphrased Ukrainian thinking like this, and this is an expression of how confusing it was. And the quote is, a special peasant phraseology was formed. We are Bolshevists, said the peasants in Ukraine, but not communists. The Bolsheviks gave us land while the communists take away our grain without giving anything for it. We will not allow the Red Army to hang the commune about our necks. Down with the commune, long live the Bolsheviks. And so you can hear from that quote, so confusing was the terminology at the time that all those sentences could easily have been written the other way around. You know, long live the communists, down with the Bolsheviks. But the point was clear. The Ukrainian peasants wanted one form of revolution, but they had got something else altogether. The rebellion destabilized everything. The Bolsheviks, the Ukrainians, the economy, and Ukraine collapsed into chaos. In the course of 1919, famously, Kiev was occupied at least a dozen times. Then at the height of the anarchy, white Imperial Russian forces under the command of Anton Denikin, a former Tsarist general, advanced into Ukraine, into this chaotic situation through the Donbass, through Kharkiv, Odessa, and eventually marched north, and he came within 200 kilometers of Moscow. Denikin failed to make common cause either with the Ukrainians or with the Poles, and so eventually he lost. But for a very brief and terrifying moment in the autumn of 1919, the Bolsheviks were frightened, because suddenly it seemed as if in Moscow itself might fall. It did not, but the Ukrainian peasant uprising had brought the counter-revolution to the brink of success. This close call was long remembered at the highest level of the Soviet regime. What Trotsky and others called the cruel lesson of 1919 was often debated and discussed for years afterward. And initially, it led to milder policies in Ukraine in the 1920s and to a new economic policy. The Bolsheviks felt that we need to do something, we need to accommodate Ukrainian nationalism, and so they came up with the policy of Ukrainianization, which was designed to persuade Ukrainians that they could be both Ukrainian and communist all at once. Nevertheless, fear of another rebellion was never very far away. And a decade later, in 1928, when two leading, very senior OGPU political policemen were writing an internal report on the political state of the countryside, even then, this is a decade after the revolution, they referred again and again to the events of 1918. They recalled how the, quote, kulaks and rural bourgeoisie, led by anti-Soviet parties, Petlurists, referring to the Petlura, the Ukrainian national leader, had fought the Bolsheviks during that kulak uprising, and they feared it could happen again. The same fears haunted Stalin himself. And in the early 1930s, when his collectivization policy began to fail, he once again became fixated on Ukraine. In the summer of 1932, as it became clear that grain yields were once again very low, this is the same summer when he's beginning to get messages from all over the country, he wrote a letter to one of his sidekicks, Lazar Kabinovich, who had long functioned as representative in Ukraine. Again, I'm quoting from his letter. The most important issue, and Stalin underlined most important issue, right now is Ukraine. Things in Ukraine have hit rock bottom. Things are bad with regard to the party. There is talk that in two regions of the Ukraine, about 50 district party committees have spoken out against, underlined, the grain procurement plan, deeming it unrealistic, underlined. But then he went on broadening his complaint from the Ukrainian Communist Party to all of Ukraine. He feared treason. He feared the influence of neighboring Poland and its leader, Joseph Pilsudski, whose army had also been in Ukraine in 1920. And above all, he feared Ukrainian nationalists who were still faithful, again, to their former leader, Simeon Petlura. I quote again, unless we begin to straighten out the situation in Ukraine, we may lose Ukraine. Keep in mind, too, that the Ukrainian Communist Party, and then he writes in parentheses, 500,000 members, ha ha, has quite a lot, yes, quite a lot of rotten elements, conscious and unconscious Petlura adherents, and finally direct agents of Pilsudski. He then gave Kaganovich his conclusion that Russia's more recent challenge, both to the Ukrainian language and to Ukrainian sovereignty, has also created a different kind of popular backlash. In 2005, less than half of Ukrainians used the language as their main form of communication. A decade later, two-thirds preferred Ukrainian to Russian. So thanks to Russian pressure, the nation is unifying behind the language in a way that it hasn't done since the 1920s. But if the study of the famine helps explain contemporary Ukraine, it also offers a guide to some of the attitudes of contemporary Russia, many of which also form part of older patterns. So from the time of the revolution, the Bolsheviks knew they were a minority in Ukraine. And to subjugate the majority, they used not only extreme violence, but also virulent and angry forms of propaganda. The Holodomor was preceded by a decade of what we would now call hate speech, language designating some people as loyal Soviet citizens and others as enemy kulaks, the privileged class that would have to be destroyed to make way for the People's Revolution. And that ideological language justified the behavior of the men and women who facilitated the famine, the people who confiscated food from starving families, the police who arrested and killed their fellow citizens. It also provided them with a kind of moral and political justification. And very few of the men and women who organized the famine ever felt guilty about it. They had been persuaded that the dying peasants were enemies of the state, they were enemies of the people, and they were dangerous criminals who had to be eliminated in the name of progress. 80 years later, the Russian FSB, which is the institutional successor of the KGB, which is itself the successor of the OGPU that carried out the famine, continues to demonize its opponents using propaganda and disinformation. So the nature and form of hate speech in Ukraine has changed, but the intentions of those who use it have not. As in the past, the Kremlin uses language to set people against one another, to create first and second class citizens, to divide and distract. In 1932 and 33, the Soviet state media described interior ministry troops working with local collaborators as, quote, Soviet patriots, and they were fighting Petlurists, kulaks, traitors, and counter-revolutionaries. In 2014, Russian state media described Russian special forces carrying out the invasion of Crimea and eastern Ukraine as separatist patriots fighting fascists and Nazis. An extraordinary disinformation campaign, you might remember, complete with fake stories that Ukrainian nationalists had crucified a baby, for example, and fake photographs and fake video followed, not only inside Russia, but on Russian state-sponsored media around the world. And though, of course, this is far more sophisticated, in many ways different from anything that Stalin could have devised, the spirit of that disinformation remains the same. 80 years later, it is also possible to hear the echo of Stalin's fear of Ukraine, or rather, his fear of unrest spreading from Ukraine to Moscow in the present as well. Stalin spoke obsessively about loss of control in Ukraine, and about Polish and other foreign plots to subvert Ukraine. He knew that Ukrainians were suspicious of centralized rule, but also that Ukrainian nationalism was a galvanizing force capable of challenging Bolshevism and even destroying it. He knew that a sovereign Ukraine could thwart the Soviet project, not only by depriving the USSR of its grain, but also by robbing it of legitimacy. Ukraine had been attached to Russia for centuries. Ukrainian and Russian culture were genuinely closely intertwined and still are. Russian and Ukrainian languages are closely related. If Ukraine had rejected Soviet ideology and the Soviet system, that rejection could cast doubt upon the whole Soviet project, which, as I say, in 1991, it did. Russia's leadership now knows exactly the same history. You know, as in 1932, when Stalin told Kaganovich that losing Ukraine was his greatest worry, the current Russian government also insists on believing that a sovereign, democratic Ukraine, a Ukraine tied to the rest of Europe by links of culture and trade, is a threat to the interests of Russia. Or rather, it's a threat to the interests of Russia's elite. After all, if Ukraine becomes too European, if it were ever to achieve anything resembling successful integration with the West, then Russians might ask, why not us? The Ukrainian street revolution of 2014 genuinely represented the Russian leadership's nightmare. There were young people calling for the rule of law, denouncing corruption, and waving European flags in the center of Kiev. You know, such a movement could have been contagious, and so it had to be stopped by whatever means possible. And today's Russian government once again uses disinformation, corruption, and military force to undermine Ukrainian sovereignty, even going to the extent of setting up mini rival states. Once again, the same kind of language is useful at home as well. Just as in 1932, this constant talk of war and enemies in Ukraine also remains useful to Russian leaders who can't explain away stagnant living standards or justify their own privileges, wealth, and power. But history offers hope as well as tragedy. In the end, the famine failed. Ukraine was not destroyed. Ukrainian language did not disappear. The desire for independence did not disappear either, and more importantly, neither did the desire for democracy, or rather for a more justice society, or even just for a Ukrainian state that truly represents Ukrainians. In the end, Stalin failed too. A generation of Ukrainian intellectuals and politicians were murdered in the 1930s, but their legacy lives on, including in places like Harvard. And the national aspiration was revived, continued underground in the 1970s, 80s, became open again in the 1990s, and a new generation of Ukrainian intellectuals and activists reappeared in the 2000s. History of the famine is a tragedy with no happy ending, but the history of Ukraine is not a tragedy. Millions of people were murdered, but the nation remains on the map. Memory of the famine was suppressed, but Ukrainians today can discuss and debate their past as we're doing here today. Although the wounds are still there, millions of Ukrainians can, as all of us can, for the first time since 1933, finally begin to heal them. Thank you very much.